So in this video, I'm going to tell you how you can build a cult fan base. What's up, guys? Brandon here from KDMR Music, the channel that teaches you how to succeed in the music business. Now, if you're new around here, we do videos every single week giving you tips about music marketing, different strategy tips, and also how to make sure your fan base is energized so that you can turn this passion you have for music into an actual business that's profitable. So if you're looking for information like that, hit the subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss any of our content. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I posted a video about how Prince made over $10 million with basically one album that he put out as a box set. And I explained how, long story short, Prince was able to do this because he had fans that were die-hard fans who, you know, would support him no matter what. And of course he had a head start doing this because he was on a major record label and he had maximum exposure at one point. But still, $10 million off one album was no small feat. Especially when you're keeping all those proceeds for yourself and not splitting them with a record label. And so, super, super great thing for Prince. But that left a lot of you guys with questions. Really, one question. How am I supposed to build this fan base? And how do I make sure they really, really love me? And, you know, I guess sometimes it does feel like it's easier said than done. But I want to break down the myth for you, right? Because, again, we want your fan base to be energized. We want them to, like, really, really do whatever you ask them to do. You don't want to run them like a cult. But there's a reason they call it a cult-like fan base. Some of the best artists with the most energized fan bases could do anything. I know you guys have seen online where they're like, man, Kanye could drop an album that's just him beating on a chair, and you guys would be like, that's the best thing ever, right? I even saw the other day, Jay-Z and Beyonce are at a Warriors game, and one of the minority owner, or one, the owner's wife, the Warriors owner's wife, is leaning over Beyonce to talk to Jay-Z, and Beyonce clearly looks annoyed. Beyonce's fans went and found the lady's Instagram and dropped a bunch of B emojis, just like, okay, you know, we're here, we don't play, right? How do you get a fan base that just locks in and will support you to no end, like Beyonce's Beehive supports her, right? Well, there are a few tips, things that I think will help you to build this fan base along the way. Now, the first, of course, is to be talented, to be extremely talented. And that doesn't mean you're born that way, but you got to work hard. You've got to do things in excellence. You've got to put out the best product that you can all the time, right? But another thing to do is, if like, from day one, pick a cause, pick a story, and stick to it. It's got to be a relatable story. Right? When Kanye West first came out, he was the college dropout who didn't wear baggy clothes and jerseys and stuff and had a song about Jesus, right? Like, these are very, very different things that he had going on. And in order to build a cult-like fan base, you've got to be different enough from everyone else, like every other artist, but also you've got to have something that you feel like puts you in common with your fans. I related to Kanye West because I didn't wear baggy clothes either at the time, right? So he gave me someone to support just from the looks of it. But then, again, even more so than just looking the part, having a story that unites your audience and your fan base behind you is a really great thing. Now, if you had to describe how Kanye's story was or unfolded, it was, you know, I'm the one who just will follow my dreams at any cost. And by me following my dreams, I'm giving other people permission to do the same thing, which made me feel like, okay, well, if I'm listening to Kanye West, then that means I'm empowering myself, right? Beyonce does this really well as well, right? Beyonce almost always has an album, or at least a song on her album, that is about women's empowerment. It speaks to places where women have been, right? I remember Me, Myself, and I, you know, about going through a bad breakup. Of course, we remember Single Ladies, about dying to be engaged, you know, even after you've been in a relationship forever, right? Or leaving someone who wouldn't ask you to marry them, right? And so Beyonce takes these stories that so many people can relate to, and she weaves them into her own narrative, right? And you've grown up with Beyonce, right? Remember when Beyonce was like 15 in a girl group? Now she's married with 3 kids, and you feel like, oh wow, like I can be like Beyonce. And now it doesn't hurt that Beyonce has been extremely successful on the business side and financially. So Beyonce stands for like bosses, women who want to boss up and be better, be that bad chick, right? And she doesn't make any apologies about it. She knows who she is, and she just stands for it. And it seems like every year, as opposed to changing directions, she just adds a layer onto it. Like with this Homecoming album, you know, that was very much about being a black woman and the things that black women go through. A lot of like what, what's that album? Lemonade. Lemonade was about as well, right? So Beyonce's really great at this. So yeah, you want to be really, really good at your craft, but then you also want to have a narrative, something that your fans can stick behind, right? But again, the third thing that you want to do is make sure that you are extremely different. Rick Rubin once said, the best art divides the audience. When you think of people who have these really huge fan bases, right? They almost always have people who are just as equally oppositely attracted to them, right? Like, you've got people who are huge Kendrick Lamar fans, and you've got other people that are like, I don't know what he's saying, he's too deep and lyrical, whatever. Like, forget Kendrick Lamar. You've got people who are like, J. Cole went platinum with no features. And you've also got people like F. J. Cole, right? Building whole careers off it. So the best art is going to have some people like, oh my gosh, this is the best thing ever. And it's going to have other people saying, I hate that guy, right? I'm not a big fan of singing Drake, although Drake keeps singing, right? But when Drake raps, I love him, right? So it's like, even I am kind of halfway on and off the Drake train. But you being who you are as an artist, doubling down on who you are, deciding who you are going to be, means that you automatically decide to stick with a certain fan base, and they reward you for that. I mean, Drake's the most streamed artist in history, right? J. Cole's the highest selling artist and grosses way more than most on tour sales, all without really marketing anything. He just puts music out, right? And then he walks around Walmart like it's a regular day, right? So the best art divides the audience. You've got to, once you figure out who you're going to be, stick to it, right? Pick your cause, pick your poison, and keep going with it. Some people love 6ix9ine. Some people are like, whatever, who is that kid, right? Some people love Taylor Swift, and other people are like, ah, she's overrated. She just makes songs about breakups, right? You're seeing a pattern here. Decide who you're going to be and be that person. And then for an extra step, name your fan base. Nothing unites people like giving them a cause, giving them a name, making them an identifiable people group. So Beyonce's got the Beehive. Nicki Minaj has her Barbies. I don't know if Drake named his fan base, actually. Taylor Swift's got the Swifties, and Rihanna's got the Navy. Maybe just the girls name fan bases, but it works out. No, Trey Songz had his Angels for a while. So, again, a lot of the biggest artists, you know, have names that they can identify their fan bases with. So then Beyonce's got something going on. It's like, oh, Beehive, unite, right? So it's really cool when you can say, oh, I'm a part of the Beehive. Oh, I'm not Beehive. I'm Rihanna Navy, right? And you guys can battle each other. So give your fan base a name. Just try not to be too corny, because once you pick it, that's the name. And, you know, maybe if you're lucky, some people pick it for you. But those are the steps to building a cult fan base, right? Those are the principles you have to stand on. Then once you start putting more of the regular music marketing practices on it to find more fans to add to this fan base, well, then you've got a winning formula, right? So if you want to know more about how to find those fans and bring them further and further down the fan journey until they are members of your fan group, your Beehive, your Rihanna Navy, well, I've got a free training that you can watch. I'll actually link to it in the description below, but it's called The Fan Journey. And I talk to you about how to go find strangers, turn them into listeners, turn them into fans, turn them into customers, and then super fans. And so I'm really excited to share that training with you. I hope to see you inside. And until next time, again, if you like this video, give me a thumbs up, leave a comment. Let me know like how you feel about growing a fan base, how difficult you think it's going to be. And I'll see you in another video very soon. Peace.